Good afternoon. My name is Scott Cordella, and I work for the MITRE Corporation. And the title of this talk is An Information Sharing Framework to Enable Cyber, Spectrum, Space Traffic Management, and Airspace Integration. I want to recognize my collaborators, John Giles, Dr. Ruth Stillwell, and Christian Zur. John is a consultant to MITRE, Ruth also a consultant, and Christian is with the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. So you see at the bottom right, the two logos, MITRE and the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, plus John and Ruth collaborating with us on this activity. MITRE is a company who operates federally funded research and development centers, FFRDCs. These are entities which are established by the federal government for the sake of purposeful work across agencies, collaborative partnerships with others, such as the U.S. Chamber. We do not compete with industry. We are working essentially in favor of an outcome that favors both industry and the federal government. So we came together with the Chamber to work broadly across the space sector, and have been working closely with them for a couple years now. So this is a joint activity. Some context in the next chart about what we're trying to address, namely information sharing. So an enabler for all aspects of cyber, air and space integration, space surveillance, space traffic management, spectrum management, and so on is information sharing. And that at core enables success for all of these missions. This is being relooked currently by federal agencies such as the Department of Commerce, the FAA, NOAA, FCC, NIST. A whole of government approach is being undertaken, essentially driven by the National Space Council and its space policy directives, SPD-2, streamlining regulatory licensing, Space Policy Directive 3, the space traffic management transfer from DOD to the Department of Commerce, Space Policy Directive 5, Cyber Best Practices, which drives the use of the NIST cybersecurity framework. So this is a time when all of these agencies are relooking the role of information sharing to fulfill the outcome of safe operations in space while preserving the business opportunities of the commercial industry. And that's meant to be shown in this bottom right, balancing proprietary information with the needs of the common good to operate successfully in space. And so this is a time where this whole topic is being relooked, and this is what we're undertaking to describe in this study. We looked at this problem in two different ways. One, first through information sharing models. That is, how are information sources of data shared? Who has access to this information? Where are the data stored? How are they retrieved? Who has access to them? These are existing models used in other domains, such as the maritime domain, the aviation domain. These are what we would call existence proofs of how information can be shared, through what mechanisms, so that proprietary information is protected, vulnerabilities are not shared to the external public, and business operates in unison to preserve the environment that they operate in, the safety of that environment, and so on. But commercial growth is also facilitated. So these models exist. And so a quick overview of the models just to remind us of these models. So in the next chart, here's a model for information sharing. We consider two classes of models, information sharing models and safety models. So here's an information sharing model for aviation, system-wide information management, or SWIM. SWIM is an existing info sharing approach in which data are shared securely through a system that is well protected from cyber attack, from spoofing. That information is personalized to the user, to that user's needs, and tailored to the user so that the user is accessing the appropriate information for the user's use cases. The system follows the appropriate tenets for cybersecurity, namely confidentiality, protection, control of networks, and so on. And as I say, it manages to balance proprietary concerns as well as the shared need for information sharing. The next chart, here's another example of an information sharing model, but for the maritime domain. Information sharing environment for maritime, namely MISE, M-I-S-E. It's comprised of four parts. Again, an information technology piece in which system access is available to the trusted users. The data are tailored to those users. A syntax, that is, information is presented using an information exchange model, namely the National Information Exchange Model, NIEM, which is tailored to the maritime domain use case. So this is an example where positional information or identity information or insurers of ships, so forth, that information is presented in a lexicon that is agreed to by everyone through this NIEM info exchange model. Common attributes for access control are shared by all of the users. And again, there's a common infrastructure that provides for reliable and controlled access. In the next chart, here's two examples of models used for safety reporting. One is ASIAS, Aviation Safety Information Analysis and Sharing, and another is ASRS, Aviation Safety Reporting System. These systems' focus is safety by the name, and they are used voluntarily by members of the community that provide data to them, for example, airlines. And they provide this information to the ASIAS system. That information is then de-identified, it's anonymized, but it's then mined retrospectively to determine if there are consistent sets of problems and risks, for example, near misses, missed approaches at runways, and so on. So it's looking backward at previous data to assess, are there problems that we need to fix going forward? Same with the Aviation Safety Reporting System, very analogous. And then one last one, the next chart, as a model for safety reporting, ASAP, Aviation Safety Action Program. This allows employees of an organization to report safety issues and so on, but without fear of reprisal. And so these protect the individual, in this case, from sharing information and then having some negative consequence. So all of these models are simply meant to demonstrate that this is being done successfully in other domains, in the air and space domain. In this next chart, then, is a laundry list of information that can be, should be shared amongst space owner operators in four different use case domains. One, space traffic management. Another, cyber protection of your systems. A third, spectrum management. And a fourth, the integration of launch through the endosphere to the exoatmosphere and then back. That is that integration of rocket launch and then reentry with air traffic. And how those information flow is the gist of this. But here's a list of all of the exampled pieces of information. I won't read them all to you, but what I'll try to do is create a framework to have a conversation about all of them simultaneously. In this next chart, we create a new concept that we call the tear line concept and hard and soft data. So imagine data that is numeric in nature, that is a number I can associate with a given parameter. For example, a two-line element for an orbit is an example of hard data for space traffic management. A planned maneuver on orbit is a piece of contextual information. It's not numeric. It is contextual information like, I plan to make the following maneuver at such and such a time. That's what I call soft data. So hard and soft data are the generalized sets of information that we would consider using against the previous chart. Then the tear line concept. So imagine a demarcation point between data that are shared amongst the community above the tear line and data that are not shared with across the community below the tear line. The tear line is that boundary between what is shared and what is not shared. And for the sake of the benefit of the community, information is shared, that is the information above the tear line, so that we can safely cohabitate. Information below the tear line is not, because that might be proprietary, it might reveal some vulnerability, something we don't need to share, because it might not even improve the safety stature of what we're doing. This, by the way, is upside down from the conventional use of tear line, where the piece that is shared is below the line, and the piece that's not shared is above the line. We flipped it upside down simply for the sake of convenience of making our point. In the next chart, then, we create a notional framework where we took data from these different use cases and populated a matrix. And that matrix is showing four different use cases: space traffic management, spectrum cyber, and air and space integration, hard and soft data for each of those four, and then examples for each of those hard and soft data columns. And then a line, a red line that we call the tear line, is a demarcation below which information is not shared and above which information is shared. It's a notional tear line in this case, and it's frankly a very fine and well-defined line in this matrix, but in reality, it's a fuzzy line. It's not so clear, and in fact, it may move up and down depending on the scenario, the timeline of the information that needs to be shared, the scenario in which it's applied, and so on. So it's a dynamic and fuzzy red line. But what you can see then is some things that we generally do share, such as two-line elements for space traffic management, or the allocated frequencies that FCC has allowed a space system to operate in, or the use of a NIST cybersecurity framework as a security architecture, as directed by Space Policy Directive 5, or the integration of air tracks and space tracks into a unified common operating picture in the airspace and integration. And similarly, soft data for those four cases, which I won't read. Notionally, though, as you dig down below the red line, you imagine there are more sets of data that will add insight into what's going on, but which may not be needed to be shared or wanted to be shared. So, for example, system health. A space system may not be operating well, but the owner-operator may choose not to share that information. Of course, it may be debatable that if he did share that information, there would be value to the community, because then they would be on the lookout or be aware of a system problem. Or in a cybersecurity example, we might perhaps share the number of attacks a given system might be subjected to, but we would not share, say, the efficacy of those attacks, because that would reveal our vulnerability. So imagine sort of things above and below this cut line, depending on the scenarios. So in the next chart, we show three different groupings. That is, those things above the line, things in the vicinity of the line, and things well below the line. So imagine things above the line. What are the characteristics of those data above that cut line? Well, these pieces of information could be externally observable. For example, ground-based systems might measure the location of a system. So why would that owner-operator choose not to share that information? It's already externally available. This information above the red line should provide value back to the provider himself. That is, to know where others are in my vicinity adds value back to me, because I know that I can, I must avoid them physically or even spectrally to know which spectra they're operating at. The middle line is a gray zone, and I'll come back to that. The bottom area is clearly information we choose not to share, because why? It may be proprietary, contain intellectual property, it may reveal health status or vulnerabilities. It may not add value to share that information with the community, so why bother? And so that's clearly well below the line. The things in the vicinity of the red line are the things that require a deeper dive. There may be some compelling safety aspects to sharing information. For example, it may be compelling to know how a collision avoidance system is operating so that the rest of us know how to maneuver away from it. That may be a proprietary piece of information now, but for the sake of common good, we should share that, is the argument. There may be value added back to owner-operators to operate more successfully with opportunities to operate. So, for example, if there's a space launch that's pending, to know very accurately where all of the other bodies are and where they'll be in that launch window will add value back to that launch provider. So there will be good value returned to the provider when others share information into this information repository. So imagine those three different categories of information sharing. Next chart, what we're doing is way of a process between the chamber and MITRE is we're interacting with industry, and we've begun that process. It's been very, very stimulating. We believe that it's very timely and relevant to the development of new civilian agency regulations, as well as practices amongst the owner operators themselves to get good value. And so we're working with industry and asking them the question, what do you see the hindrances, boundaries, and opportunities for information sharing? We get a resounding positive feedback that there is good opportunity here, and there are numerous constructs such as the maritime and aviation domains. There are some legacy space information sharing constructs as well, but now with the proliferation of low Earth orbit, there's a new opportunity and need to relook how information is shared and what information is shared and why share a given set and not another set. And that's the relationship between the regulatory oversight role of the government and the commercial benefit role of information sharing. And we're looking for that construct. What we did discover even in this early time is that there's not an enormous pushback from industry for information sharing. There is a general agreement so far as we can tell that information sharing is a business benefit to industry, and that only when we get well below that cut line, say showing vulnerabilities, is it clear that industry does not wish to share that information. There is a good and healthy debate in that middle ground where the return on information provided back is the calculation that needs to be made, and that's what we're going to dig more deeply into. So to close, what we found is there is a good reason for continued interaction with industry to develop new information sharing models for space. This will impact future info sharing systems, such as Department of Commerce's Open Architecture Data Repository, which is a response to Space Policy Directive 3, or others, NIST's Cybersecurity Framework, a response to SPD-5, FAA's relook at some of the licensing processes, FCC's, same with them, and NOAA's. The whole of government is relooking these questions, and so there's an opportunity to impact the ultimate systems that do this information sharing. This is particularly relevant to today because of the proliferation of low Earth orbit, and so we believe that this is the right thing to do at the right time. So we look forward to telling you more about our progress as we go forward. Thank you for your time and attention, and we'll stay in touch.